Hello, everyone. Welcome to this presentation on the story of JFK Jr., America's son. And so, in preparing for this event, I read three books. I'll tell you about two right now. So, first, I read this one, The Good Son, JFK Jr. and the Mother He Loved, written by Christopher Anderson. I read this one. JFK Jr., George and Me, written by Matt Berman, a memoir written by his business partner and one of the last people he spoke to before he died. I will tell you about the third book once we get to the part of the story that's relevant to that part of it. And of course, I need a copious amount of notes that I'll be referring to throughout. And I think it'll be a very interesting presentation. I'd like to give you a fair warning. I am in a room at the moment, and so you may occasionally hear the sounds of church bells. It can't be helped, so I hope you will bear with me. And now, without further ado, I will share my screen and we can get started. Okay. So, all his life, he was intrigued by the obsessive interest people had in his parents, because to him, they were just mommy and daddy. And he didn't even remember daddy. In the same vein, he never understood why people were so obsessed with him, because his older sister, Caroline, didn't draw nearly as much attention as he did. Their father, President John F. Kennedy, was emblematic of a time in America that was innocent and full of hope. It was a time before the Vietnam War, before HIV/AIDS, before the Watergate scandal, and so on. And as JFK's only son, he was ex expected to pick up that dynastic torch. It was a pressure that he had lived with from childhood, like a prince who is heir to the throne. He was almost trapped by all these expectations everybody had of him. His mother believed that it was his destiny and that she was raising a future American president. So he was born on November 25th, 1960, in Washington, and his father had just been elected president. The first 6 days of his life were spent in an incubator because John, as he was famously called, had been born 3 weeks early and with breathing problems. In spite of all this, the mood at the hospital, and indeed all over the country, was very buoyant and joyous. There was this sense of exhilaration, jubilation, almost like a carnival after he was born. And he had arrived just 2 days before his older sister Caroline's birthday. And for the longest time, she thought he belonged to her because she had been told that he was her birthday present. She really believed it. So their mother, Jackie, was about to become First Lady of the United States. She was recovering from a C-section. She was planning the inauguration and she was figuring out how she was going to revamp the White House. And so, needless to say, she didn't have too much time to spend with her newborn. And so, John was mostly cared for by nannies, but never ever neglected by their parents, ever. Even their dad, despite all his womanizing, President Kennedy was an exceptionally doting and devoted dad. I mean, you see all these pictures of him with the children. He was absolutely in love with his children, just completely smitten with them. He He called Caroline Buttons, and he called John Jr. John. And their mother, Jackie, was also a very hands-on mom. Like, as far as possible. And like most mothers who have endured miscarriages and stillbirths, she was overprotective. The first thing she moved into the White House were toys for her children. And then she also had John's nursery renovated before she even thought of bringing any of the family's other things into the White House. She would jump on the trampoline as she watched her children play outside or all over the White House. John wouldn't remember all of this, of course. He was too young. He was learning to ride horses before he could even walk because their mother was an accomplished equestrian, something she had also done from childhood and something she tried to imbibe into her children, even though John was allergic to horses. The country couldn't get enough of the Kennedy family and their kids. So magazines published pictures of the children on a weekly basis. Jackie wanted to limit access to her children, but her husband saw the political advantage in having America fall in love with their children. And so he ensured that Time magazine, Newsweek, Life, and Look magazine all got photo shoots with the children. Life. Jackie didn't really like it, but there was nothing she could do. Even during staff meetings, even when cameras were not present, President Kennedy will tickle his son, play with him, smell his hair. He was just besotted with the children. John and Caroline were loved and they knew it. I mean, just look at their childhood pictures. I guess it was a good thing to have these pictures to look back on because of what was to come. Even when their father was in the Oval Office and talking to a member of his cabinet or another head of state, if John came into the Oval Office, President Kennedy would interrupt whatever call or meeting he was having and attend to John. John was his priority. So, from an early age, John developed a deep love for airplanes. The Kennedy family had a private jet. The Kennedys were constantly aboard Air Force One and Marine One and many other planes. And actually, John's favorite was Marine One. He loved helicopters. When there wasn't a helicopter around, John became a helicopter. A lot of the things he and his father did together was connected to airplanes. He was always spinning around and making helicopter noises. His father even called him a helicopter head. Do this for hours. He and his father. They'll go down to the hangar and sit in the helicopter and pretend they're flying for hours at a time. Hours. The majority of his toys were airplanes and helicopters. They'll be on a helicopter ride together. He had a replica of Marine One and a replica of Air Force One. So, John's lifelong love of aviation was born right then, and it never left him. Flying was in his blood. Sometimes, when he was crying, the only thing that could pacify him was the promise that he would go on a helicopter ride. And a thing he said all the time as a child is, "My daddy is going to buy me a real plane when I grow up," was just a statement he made over and over again.
His passion for planes was so fierce that even as a toddler, his parents worried. On several occasions, Secret Service officers had to drag him kicking and screaming off of airplanes. All this to say, there's nothing anyone could have done to prevent John from going into aviation as an adult. So, with this secure, active childhood and with being constantly photographed from an early age, John developed an ease before the camera, and he could light up a room like nobody's business. Even as a child, he was like a little diplomat, a natural-born political star. He had an idyllic childhood, but he did not remember most of it. He mostly recalled the pets they had at the White House, the cats, the dogs, and the ponies. For instance, Neil Diamond was actually inspired to write his song Sweet Caroline after seeing Caroline riding her pony Macaroni at the White House. So, in this picture, taken on October 3rd, 1963, we see JFK Jr. at Andrews Air Force Base weeping because his father left on Air Force One, and Air Force One left him behind. Not so much for his dad, but the airplane, because he was hoping to get a ride on Air Force One. And a similar scene occurred in November 1963, that's just the following month, when his dad said goodbye to him and boarded the flight to Dallas, where he was assassinated. So many of us have grown accustomed to seeing that video of them in the car, right? Just in the moments before the assassination happened. And it's a piece of history to us. We view it and it feels clinical almost. But for the family, it was an exceptionally painful video to watch. Imagine having to relive your father's assassination, your husband's assassination. So after the assassination, when Jackie got back to the White House, she couldn't tell the children that their father had died. She didn't have the heart to do it. And so she asked their nanny to break the news to them as gently as she could. The day their father died, the Secret Service and all the adults around the White House kept the children distracted the rest of that day. They played and ran around as usual. A lot of high-ranking government officials descended on the White House that day. And each time one of their helicopters landed on the White House lawn, John would shout, "Daddy's home." They didn't know their father had died. The nanny didn't tell John that night, but she decided to tell Caroline just as she was putting her to bed. And Caroline sobbed herself to sleep. Took her hours to fall asleep. And then the following morning, John was told that Daddy has gone to heaven. And he responded, "Did Daddy take his big plane with him? I wonder when he's coming back." Like most kids that age, he didn't comprehend death, its permanence. So after they'd been told, Jackie hugged them that morning, and they all wrote letters that they were placing their father's casket. She was only able to cope in the following days because the family doctor regularly gave her amphetamine injections mixed with steroids, because back then it wasn't known that they were addictive. So meanwhile, being that the Kennedys were an Irish family, they grieved very differently. So after JFK died at the White House, his brothers were there, his entire family. They're laughing, singing, eating, and drinking. Jackie and the kids just watched it all. They heard lots of stories about President Kennedy's life and childhood. His own brothers were the ones leading this. And you know, they were a very close-knit family. And so even though it seemed like a party atmosphere, This was the only way they could cope with JFK's assassination. And so JFK's funeral was set for November 25th, 1963, which was his son's third birthday. Personally, I think it was a horrendous decision to bury him on his birthday. And so JFK Jr. woke up that morning, and then they sang happy birthday to him at breakfast, and he opened his present. And then 1 hour later, he was heading to his father's funeral. T 220 representatives from 102 countries came to Washington for the funeral. To her credit, Jackie raised her children very, very well and drilled impeccable manners into them. And so she was confident that they will always know how to comport themselves in public and not embarrass her and family. You know exactly how to conduct themselves in public. So because it was John's third birthday, Jackie refused to dress him in black for the funeral, opting to instead dress him in blue suit and red shoes. So the family watched the horse-drawn caisson as it took the slain president to his final resting place. And then as he was passing in front of them, Jackie leaned towards John and whispered, "John, you can salute Daddy now and say goodbye to him." And we're going to watch a video clip of that moment.
From St. Matthew's, the cortege is to cross the Potomac to the Cemetery of Heroes, Arlington. As the casket is returned to the caisson, there comes a family vignette that must take its place with those memories we hold warm and dear. A gentle reminder from his mother, and John John celebrates his third birthday with a soldier's farewell to his father.
This moment cemented John's place in the hearts of Americans. It felt as if there was a death in the family for all Americans. It's hard to imagine it now, given the current climate in America and all the division, but there was a time when it was such a united country. John did not remember that moment. He said, quote, "I've seen that photograph so many times. I'd like to say I remember that moment, but I don't." And so, the night of her husband's funeral, Jackie had the bodies of the two babies she had lost flown to Arlington Cemetery, where they were buried next to their father. So now that Jackie and her husband's graves, and then the two babies she lost, and the eternal flame. And so they're buried by candlelight that night in a secret second funeral in total darkness. And then after that, she went home and presided over her son's third birthday party. She just buried her husband, and this is John's third birthday party that same night. So America grieved with them. Everywhere they went, people broke down and wept. Secret Service agents kept crying. On several occasions, hysterical women broke through police barriers to hug and kiss the Kennedy kids. And their mother was concerned about the level of love and the outpouring of grief that people expressed. And she was mostly concerned about how her children would be if they continued to get coddled by the whole country. She said, quote, "The world is pouring terrible adoration at their feet, and I fear for them." And so, from age three, JFK Jr. began receiving this level of adoration from the American public, and it never diminished until the day he died. So after losing his father, he kept searching for a father figure. Well, there was a Secret Service agent named Agent Foster, whom John was particularly close to. And John started calling him Daddy. And no matter what this agent or anyone said or did, John continued to call him Daddy, and Jackie just couldn't take it. And so she eventually had Agent Foster reassigned. It was just too painful. And another thing that he missed about his dad was getting thrown up in the air. Just something he loved. And so whenever he saw an adult male around, he'd walk up to him and ask, "Are you a daddy? Will you throw me up in the air?" He just loved it. So his uncle Bobby, Robert Kennedy, became the father figure in his life. Following the assassination, they saw each other every day for years. And actually, Jackie wanted Uncle Bobby to adopt both her kids officially. But his wife, Ethel, put the kibosh on it. She'll have none of it. Because she, Ethel, grew concerned about her husband's growing closeness to Jackie, and with good reason. Jackie was understandably lonely, and having her brother-in-law around really helped her cope with the grief. There were always crowds of people with cameras camped outside the family home, and most of them were women, and they seemed more focused on JFK Jr. than on his sister, even from that age. And it scared the little boy, and so soon the family moved to New York City. So the first Easter after their father died, at an Easter egg hunt, John and another four-year-old boy got into a fight over a toy truck. Jackie grabbed the toy and gave it to the other boy, and she then spanked her son because her expectations for him were monumental. She was extremely strict and domineering to him. Presidents, prime ministers, and kings often dropped by at their lavish five-bedroom, five-bathroom apartment in Manhattan. He lived on the 15th floor of this building. Jackie furnished it to her taste, and it remained unchanged for the next 30 years. Let me show you pictures of the interior. That's the hallway. There was only one photograph of her late husband in the entire apartment, just a small one in her bedroom, because she didn't want the children focused on their dead father and all the assassins. She didn't want that to dominate their lives. John loved living there. They would spy on people from the balcony using their high-powered telescope. And he was a very naughty boy, so he sometimes would throw things on pedestrians walking below. The one-year anniversary of JFK's death was agony for the family, because that video of the assassination was replayed on television over and over and over again. All the newspapers were about JFK. His face was everywhere, on every bus, every store window. Like, it was so hard on her that she once walked from her apartment to the salon and then burst into tears. It was as if it just happened again. It just brought it all back. It was very, very hard for them. And again, they leaned on Uncle Bobby, RFK, who by this time was actually sleeping with Jackie. I guess people grieve the way they can, and they use strange ways to cope, so I don't judge. It was very strange for John and his sister Caroline to see their uncle and their mother openly kissing on the mouth and holding hands. Like, all their close friends and family knew about the affair, but the public would have never believed it.
And the affair went on for 3 years. So it was difficult, but Jackie ensured that the Secret Service agent did not spoil her children because she wanted them to grow up and be as normal as possible. At school, John got into a lot of fist fights with other boys, most of which he won. Good for him. In 1965, John took his first trip abroad to England, where he met Queen Elizabeth. In the UK, the media attention on him was even more relentless. On this trip, Jackie noticed that her children were extremely close to their nanny of 7 years, Mrs. Maud Shaw, the woman who had broken the news of their father's death to them. She was very close to those children. And so Jackie fired her. Jackie could be ruthless. So Ms. Shaw wrote a book about her time at the White House with the Kennedy children. The children continued to write to her for the rest of her life. So back in the US, 4-year-old John started school at St. David's, and he was regularly photographed being walked to school by his mom. His mother was very protective of her children's privacy, and she fired any of her staff that shared any information about her children, no matter how trite. Jackie found it very easy to cut people off. Out of sight, out of mind was her motto. The family holidayed in Antigua, Sun Valley, Stowe, and Stade. They even came here to Rome and met the Pope for a private audience. They and their mother appeared in countless magazines all around the world, and Jackie was named the world's most admired woman 6 years in a row. They were very popular. So these children were used to fame all their lives on a global scale. And they also experienced a lot of jealousy and envy from other children and their parents at school, which was very hard on John. He was a very polite, well-mannered little boy who didn't ask for any of this attention that, you know, was poured on him. He never asked for it. Sometimes at school, groups of children would follow them around chanting, "Your father is dead, your father is dead." And John was so well behaved, he never even responded to them. And there was a time that Jackie also got to experience it firsthand on the third anniversary of her husband's death, when a group of children followed her and John from school to their apartment chanting, "Your father is dead, your father is dead." How cruel. So Jackie encouraged her children to invite regular children that they met at the park over to the house for lunch or dinner on several occasions. Every attempt was made to show them the other side of life and how regular people lived. She made them donate their toys to the less fortunate at Christmas and visit soup kitchens. This is not often reported, but Jackie was involved with a lot of different men in the years between her husband's death and her marriage to Onassis. She dated many, many men, but very secretly. And her children read about it in the papers all the time when they said, "Oh, she's been spotted with this person or that person." But people didn't know she was actually dating them. So in the meantime, Jackie was putting out feelers about Aristotle Onassis, the richest man in the world at the time. She was asking questions about him, researching his wealth, and so on. She was secretly dating him, among others. He constantly showered her with gifts, sent her love notes and flowers. You know, Jackie had been raised to marry money, and Onassis was an ambitious social climber, because despite being the richest man in the world, he lacked social credibility. But marrying the most famous woman in the world
a woman who could outshine both Princess Grace of Monaco and even Queen Elizabeth, he knew that that would give him instant credibility. Plus, the world was obsessed with John and with Caroline, and so having them as his stepkids would be an added bonus. Jackie also considered marrying Onassis because, you know, he had the money to provide the kind of lifestyle she wanted and the protection. But at the time, Uncle Bobby was running for president and he would have none of it, because Jackie's married to Onassis would sink him. And so Jackie postponed her plans of marrying until after the elections. Shortly before the election, a man whom John and Caroline knew was killed. That was Martin Luther King Jr. He was also gunned down, just like their father. JFK Jr. was very sad about Martin Luther King's passing. And then on June 5th, 1968, immediately after winning the primary in California, Bobby Kennedy was also assassinated, just like their dad. So JFK Jr. didn't remember his father, but he remembered Uncle Bobby. And so this assassination haunted him the rest of his life, because this time he was old enough to remember. He experienced his mother's grief this time around. And he was on that train ride that took his uncle's body to Washington for the funeral. And this is the first time that he realized the magnitude of the Kennedy legend. Because millions of people across many states spontaneously went and stood by the train tracks to watch the train go past with his body in it. So we're going to watch a short video clip of that train ride. And if you pay attention, there's a part where you see JFK Jr. at the window of the train looking out on that historic train ride. So let's see that video.
as they are and say why. I dream things that never were and say why not.
People were weeping in the streets. That was the end of the American dream. So the day after the funeral, Jackie decided that it was time to marry Onassis and leave America, because she was sure that they were going to kill her children next. And so she began to warm her family and friends to the idea of her getting remarried, even though she didn't tell them to whom she was going to get remarried. So as for Onassis, her family and friends thought he was Eurotrash. And besides, he was still having an affair with the opera singer Maria Callas. Onassis charmed John and Caroline. He was affectionate and doted on them. They took walks together, swam together, played board games for hours. He acted like a dad, and he paid a particular attention to John, whom he viewed as a future president. So imagine the influence he would have had, you know, the bragging rights that he raised an American president. So with John, they listened to President Kennedy's speeches together repeatedly, and he assured John that he had zero intention of replacing his dad because John idolized his father. And so while Jackie secretly planned her wedding and hammered out the financial deals in her prenup, she told her children nothing. Meanwhile, John was notorious at school for punching anybody who called him John, or actually anybody who talked smack about him, because his Secret Service agents had taught him boxing. His controlling mother forced him to wear shorts to school whilst all the other boys were wearing trousers. And if you teased him about it, you'll get a bloody nose. So when Jackie had something important to tell her children, she always took them on a handsome cab ride because it was private and they couldn't run away. They couldn't escape. They would have to sit and listen to whatever she had to say. And that was exactly how she broke the news of her marriage to Onassis, to the kids. John says that after she told them, like they were so shocked that it even until his adulthood, he remembered the sound of the hooves of the horses because they were so quiet, they were so stunned. So after telling her children, she began to frantically call all her friends and family to tell them about her upcoming wedding because it was about to hit the newspapers and she wanted them to be prepared for it. So everybody was upset. And soon the news spread across America like wildfire. And nobody was happy about it. So there were headlines like this. And that. And then after the news spread at school, a boy said in front of the class, quote, "John's mother explained why she's marrying a frog instead of a prince. Because when he croaks, we will all be rich," end quote. John gave that boy a bloody lift. So everybody was upset about it. The only person who didn't mind was their grandmother, Rose Kennedy. Because Jackie was a very, very expensive daughter-in-law. But now she would no longer be their responsibility. And the other person who had a very interesting reaction to the news of their upcoming wedding was Maria Callas, who had been seeing Onassis for years. She
reacted exactly the way you would expect a Greek opera singer to react. She opened the windows of her Paris apartment and screamed into the night. The whole of Paris heard her scream that night. So John and his sister were whisked off to Scorpios in Greece for the wedding. And they looked as if they were at a funeral. They're so sad. There's Caroline. And poor John had his head bowed down the entire time. And even Onassis's children were openly weeping at the funeral. They were that sad about it. The only people who were happy about it were Jackie and Onassis, who was so drunk he could barely stand straight. He was inebriated. Anyway, he bribed Jackie's entire family with diamonds and rubies at the wedding reception. He gave John a speedboat, a horse, and a jeep. And he got Caroline a boat and a Shetland pony. He would regularly have hot dogs bought from Coney Island and flown to Athens anytime the children wanted them. As for John, he enjoyed spending time below deck with the crew on Onassis's yacht, the Christina, which was one of the biggest yachts in the world at the time. So little John would spend time below deck scrubbing pots and learning all about boats. Onassis was a devoted stepdad who spoiled the Kennedy children rotten. Whatever they wanted, they got. But within days of the wedding, his marriage to Jackie began to fall apart, and Onassis called it the biggest mistake of his life. Oh, too late. Jackie, on the other hand, was giddy to be married to the richest man in the world. She had 70 servants and 65 bodyguards and more homes and apartments around the world than she could count. So they had a 3-week honeymoon, and then she returned to Manhattan with her children, and Onassis was back in the bed of Maria Callas, whom he continued to see until the day he died. So even though he had a horrible marriage with Jackie, with JFK Jr., he pursued a genuine father-son relationship, even canceling business meetings to spend one-on-one time with John. And he is one of the few adults who really listened to John and was genuinely interested in what he thought and what he had to say. He showed up for as many school events as possible. And actually, because because Onassis and Jackie regularly showed up for school events, it shamed a lot of the parents at this school, and they started showing up too, because if Jackie O and the richest man in the world could make the time to show up, then what was your excuse for not showing up for your child? So John and Onassis had a very playful relationship. They chased each other around, they tickled each other, and every night they hugged each other goodnight. But there was always an invisible barrier that remained in place because John just refused to get close to another man. For the duration of the marriage, he called him Mr. Onassis. And in later life, John said of Onassis, quote, he was too old, too foreign, too rich, too much. And believe it or not, John and his sister got along perfectly with them, Onassis's children. John was particularly close to Alexander Onassis. They both love airplanes. And Alexander, who was a licensed pilot by age 20, took John on multiple flights in the family helicopter and plane. Meanwhile, Jackie was burning through her husband's fortune. She blew $2 million on clothes during the first year of their marriage. 2 million. And that was back then. Saint Laurent, Dior, Valentino,
Givenchy, Lanvin, and Chanel all built mannequins in Jackie's exact specifications to keep up with her orders. And Jackie was a pointer, the kind of shopper who never looked at the prices of things. She just pointed, I want this, 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 and that. She once walked into a shop and blew $320,000 on bags, scarves, and sweaters in under 15 minutes. And the salesperson attending to her went into shock and had to be sedated and taken home. Jackie just blew money. So just as had happened in her first marriage, her second marriage began to be fraught with quarrels about her spending. Only this time, they openly quarreled in front of her children about her spending habits. So Jackie and Onassis spent even less time together. Back in New York, the press was getting more aggressive, given, you know, Jackie's perceived betrayal in getting remarried. And it even trickled down to the children, because sometimes photographers would taunt John or throw stones at him, hoping to get an angry reaction, or hoping he would throw the stones back at them so they could photograph him. The paparazzi stalked them so much that John described it as a big, annoying game of hide and seek. And all of this happened before he was 9 years old. Imagine living such an eventful life. So Ari Onassis found out that Jackie was having an affair with a man named Roswell Gilpatrick, and he decided to take his revenge by openly flaunting his affair with Maria Callas in order to humiliate Jackie, particularly given how the American press was treating her now. It was a move that was calculated to humiliate her. Jackie didn't want to be made a laughing stock, and so she tried to play it off like their marriage was still solid. Ari Onassis began to refer to Jackie as the widow. He despised her, and he openly showed it, and John witnessed all of it firsthand. So with the marriage collapsing, Onassis got distant and aloof with John. But luckily, John had purposely refused to get close to Onassis anyway, after losing his dad and Uncle Bobby. And it was the only time in John's life that he ever saw his mother engage in angry, shouting matches, smashing plates, and all that kind of arguing. Hard to believe that, you know, Jackie engaged in something like that, but it was a very turbulent marriage that she had with Onassis. Very, very turbulent. Onassis even set her up to get photographed naked whilst sunbathing. And you can look up the pictures if you want. I'm not going to share them here. It deeply embarrassed Jackie and the children, but Onassis no longer cared about her. He was already telling people that he's getting ready to divorce the Black Widow. In 1972, when John was 12 years old, he tried to sign up for flying lessons on a Cessna, but Jackie said absolutely not. And she told him, quote, "We cannot tempt fate in this family. I will never let my children fly." But you need to understand that John never even met his Uncle Joe Jr. Uncle Joe Jr. died in a plane crash before his father became president, before he was even born. His aunt, Kathleen, died in a plane crash. His uncle, Ted Kennedy, was involved in a plane crash. He survived it. Ethel Kennedy lost both her parents in a plane crash, also lost her brother in a plane crash. And then in January 1973, Alexander Onassis also died, yes, in a plane crash. So Jackie just didn't see this as something her children should do. He was only 24 years old when he died.
Onassis's grief made the marriage even worse. He was so overcome with grief. He lost all interest in life. And he took things out on Jackie even more. He even began to hit her in the face. He once gave Jackie a black eye. People just didn't notice because she always wore her signature dark glasses. Hard to believe Jackie endured physical abuse in her marriage. So John and his sister were terrified of Onassis and the marriage at this point. And, you know, at this stage, they were old enough to read, you know, all the bitter and intimate details about the pending divorce in the papers for months. John just wanted to run away from his life and get away from it. So he began to sneak away from his Secret Service detail so he'd get some alone time to just think. Because right from birth, he'd always been surrounded by the Secret Service. He never had privacy growing up. And soon it became like an adventure for him to go off and do his own thing. And it was something his mom encouraged him to do. And he loved to do things that push the limits, do risky things, because he grew up so sheltered and so overprotected. So he loved danger. It was thrilling. And so from his teenage years, he smoked Greek cigarettes and marijuana. And he occasionally drank his favorite drink of choice as a teen, which was Johnny Walker. He probably had ADD because he could not sit still or focus on anything for long. As a student, he was mediocre at best, but he was still one of the most loved by all of his classmates. Very down to earth, you know, just a regular guy, no airs at all. Very humble person. People loved that about him. Classmates who visit him at home noticed that the entire wall in his bedroom were covered in pictures of his father. Absolutely idolized his father. And because he was bullied so much at school, John always stood up for the underdog at school or for anyone who was being bullied. He always defended people who were getting bullied. Something he continued to do into adulthood. He had such empathy for others because he had experienced so much pain. When he was 14 years old, he went on a bike ride in Central Park. And he was mugged by a drug addict who shoved him and stole his bicycle. It made national news. And so while his mother was happy that her son got to experience ordinary New York life, on the other hand, she was angered that the Secret Service slacked and they weren't there to protect him. And she warned them that she wouldn't let them get away with anything happening to her son, like had happened to her husband. Meanwhile, Aristotle Onassis died before he could file for divorce. He died on March 15th, 1975, while Jackie was in New York City, and she refused to go see him. Jackie was a merry widow. She seemed cheerful when she learned that Onassis had died. And so the merry widow's first call after hearing of his death was to Senator Ted Kennedy to tell him that she would need his help in negotiating a bigger cash settlement than what was stated in her prenup. And her second call was to Valentino to order a black designer dress for the funeral. She was quite insensitive at the funeral, and she was actually photographed smiling. Something that the Greeks never forgave her for, smiling at her second husband's funeral. And right at the funeral, Jackie and Ted Kennedy were already hounding Onassis's daughter, Christina, about money, even before her father body had been put into the ground. Christina Onassis was now the richest woman in the world, but she was also the poster child for the phrase, money doesn't buy happiness.
She attempted suicide multiple times and actually became a drug addict. Anyway, Christina eventually gave Jackie $26 million. So watching the Onassis kids was a wake-up call for Jackie, and so she put her children on a tighter leash. And the number one way to do this was to keep them away from their cousins on the Kennedy side. Because those Kennedy kids, they did drugs, they vandalized boats, they shot BB guns at passing motorists, they ambushed and robbed tourists for fun, and they drove whilst intoxicated. I think one of them actually got a passenger in the car paralyzed from the waist down. They were wild. And Jackie wanted none of that for her children. So John still smoked pot until his death. And he and his sister grew marijuana on the rooftop garden that Jackie had. And Jackie didn't know about it. John once stole a car in Switzerland for a joyride. And as a teen, the Secret Service saved him from a few bar fights or from girls who just wouldn't take no for an answer. So he was, still a bad boy, but nothing close to what his Kennedy cousins were like. And most summers, Jackie purposely sent John abroad on some adventure trip just to keep him away from the Kennedy headquarters, aka Hyannis Port. She didn't want him to end up like his cousins. And also, there was always this undercurrent of jealousy toward John from the Kennedy cousins. Because we're a very, very competitive family. And, John, even at that age, was the total package when it came to looks, manners, sophistication, heart, wealth, check, check, check. And he was seen as the crown prince of the family. And so they envied him and they were horrible to him. His cousins were horrendous to him. It was hard being expected to be perfect all the time, especially for John, who never excelled at school. He tried to ship Onassis's motorbike to America, but Jackie confiscated it. And she also refused to buy him a car when he turned 16 and all his mates were getting cars, because she knew how reckless he could be. His first real girlfriend was a girl named Meg Azzoni. There they are. He was 16 years old at the time. And all the girls at their school, the Andover Academy, hated her, and so did all the female teachers. John and Meg got fake IDs, which they used for sneaking into pubs. He was a very naughty, mischievous student. And he always knew that the rules of life would never really apply to him. He just had that aura of quiet confidence that he'd always be taken care of. But he wasn't a bad person. He did volunteer work in Guatemala after an earthquake, where he spent hours in the sun helping to rebuild damaged homes. He was a very hardworking person. And even on this trip, girls threw themselves at him all the time. And everywhere he went, he extinguished every other man in the room. So imagine never having to make an effort with people all your life. He went to concerts or games without tickets and still got in. He never carried cash or credit cards with him, but his meals or drinks were always paid for. He was already worth $5 million as a teenager from, the Kennedy money. He would teach English to immigrants, and he built fences at a dude ranch in Wyoming. He did community outreach with the juveniles, and he went on all kinds of adventures. He once got lost whilst bushwhacking in Kenya. And Maasai warriors needed to be deployed to track him down. Yale Harvard, Princeton, and all the other Ivy League universities wanted him. He received, open invitation from them, but he instead chose to attend Brown University because he knew he didn't have the, pedigree to, he wouldn't measure up academically at the more prestigious ones. And at Brown, he drew attention from the press and the girls. It's unbelievable the number of girls who tried to sleep with him when he was at Brown University. It would have been so easy, but allegedly he rejected most of them. He developed a passion for acting at Brown University, and he was an incredible actor. But Jack refused to let him pursue acting. In fact, she even refused an offer that he received to play his dad in a biopic documentary. In 1982, his mother finally allowed him to get his driver's license. But within a year, he had racked up so many speeding tickets and other driving infractions in so many states that that in Massachusetts, his driving license was suspended. He ignored it and continued driving anyway. He also crashed several of his friends' cars on a regular basis. By his early 20s, he looked like a god and he knew it. And so he was regularly photographed shirtless, playing sports in parks, or on the beach with his friends. Always, always shirtless. His friends called him Mr. Adonis. Anytime he was around them, none of them could get girls. But John obtained his bachelor's degree in history, and his mom told him that the next step for him was law school. But first, he decided to take some time off and go for another adventure. He joined a crew looking for a sunken ship, trying to find the treasure. He kept very active because he hated sitting still to reflect on his life. He said, quote, "If I stop to think about it all, I'll just sit down and fall apart," because he knew all the expectations that came with being him. And so he always kept active, always went running, biking, skiing, kayaking, water skiing, skydiving, rollerblading, or hiking, always, always on the go. Even, into his adulthood, his birthday was always a very difficult day for him because of the assassination anniversary. And so, with the 20th anniversary of his father's death coming up, he decided to go to India for 3 months, and he was there doing charity work with Mother Teresa. When he got back to the US after this, he invited a bunch of friends over to watch the game at his home. But when he turned the TV on, he was very embarrassed because he'd left one of his porn videos in. He was mortified. Anyway, one of John's more serious first relationships was with Christina Hagg. They were together for 5 years, 5 tempestuous years, due to John's jealousy. He was a very, very jealous partner. He used to refer to her as the girl I'm going to marry. Jackie even gave him her own engagement ring because she approved, and she actually thought they would marry. But of course, it didn't happen. John was the best man at his sister's wedding in 1986. And that year, People magazine named him America's most eligible bachelor. Later that same year, he enrolled at New York University Law School. In 1988, the Democratic National Convention took place in Atlanta, and 27-year-old JFK Jr. was there to introduce his uncle, Ted. One journalist who was present said that it felt as if the air pressure dropped the minute John walked on stage. For many Americans, actually many people around the world, it was the first time they ever heard him speak. And he was just 27 years old, but he sounded like a seasoned statesman. So let's see that video, and then we'll talk on the other side.
The future, John Fitzgerald Kennedy Jr.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Over a quarter century ago, my father stood before you to accept the nomination for the presidency of the United States. So many of you came into public service because of him. In a very real sense, because of you, he is with us still. And for that, I'm grateful to all of you. I owe a special debt to the man his nephews and nieces call Teddy. Not just because of what he means to me personally, but because of the causes he has carried on. He has shown that an unwavering commitment to the poor, to the elderly, to those without hope, regardless of fashion or convention, is the greatest reward of public service. I'm not a political leader, but I can speak for those of my age who have been inspired by Teddy to give their energy and their ideas to their community and not just to themselves. Thank you. Thank you. In that ongoing effort, young people, and not only the young, but all like-minded citizens, all of you, will be guided by the honorable and unyielding example of the senior senator from Massachusetts. He has shown that our hope is not lost idealism, but a realistic possibility. America is better because of the leadership of Edward Kennedy. Thank you. May he continue to guide us for many years to come. Ladies and gentlemen, my uncle, Ted Kennedy.
So many young people got more interested in politics after seeing John. And then there was this yearning that someday this son of America could possibly become president. This one whom everybody had watched grow up. It seemed almost cosmic, you know, following, you know, his father's assassination and everything. So after this, on September 2nd, 1988, People magazine crowned him the sexiest man alive. You know, in my opinion, he's one of the few people who truly deserve this title. I've never found one bad picture of this guy, and I looked. Mine was photographed all the time. I couldn't find one bad picture of him online. You can try if you want. And even today, how many celebrities can compete with him? Like even today. His own male friends, straight men, said sometimes they would find themselves just taken aback by how good looking he was in person. Well, Jackie, his mother, wasn't amused by the sexiest man alive title at all, because her husband had been a notorious womanizer and she didn't want that for her son. But John took it all in good fun. He joked about it. And this title helped him because it opened so many doors for him all over the world, so many bedroom doors. On any given day, he would tell his friends to go check out the cover of, you know, Vogue magazine, Vanity Fair, or, you know, any other magazine. And he would tell them, just so you know, I've been with that one too. And his mom was very concerned. Didn't want her son like being like her father. And the affair that President Kennedy had, which had bothered her the most, was the one he'd had with Marilyn Monroe. And so when her son, John Jr., got involved with a blonde singer named Madonna, Jackie was concerned. Because back in the 80s, Madonna was, I guess, as famous as Monroe used to be back in the 50s and 60s. Madonna had the same platinum blonde hair as Marilyn Monroe. And Madonna's video for Material Girl paid homage to Marilyn Monroe's Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend. So Jackie didn't like all those parallels. Madonna had just divorced Sean Penn, and then she went after JFK Jr. And JFK Jr. was completely in awe of Madonna. Even introduced her to his mother. But Jackie wasn't happy about the relationship at all. One time, Madonna came to Rome, and she got drunk. And then she called John's home and left him a very raunchy voice message, which Jackie had the pleasure of listening to. And, you know, whilst he was seeing Madonna, he was still with his steady girlfriend, Christina Hag, and she had no idea. She nearly caught him once when she smelled Madonna's perfume on him. But he gave her some excuse and she bought it. And John hadn't even broken things off with Madonna yet when one day he got up from a flight and a woman showed up at at the airport and invited him into her limousine. It was Sarah Jessica Parker. So she showed up unannounced at the airport in a limousine. She wore a pair of stilettos and a mink coat with nothing under. And she invited John into the limousine, back of her limo. Their affair lasted a few months. And so he was seeing three women at the same time. His mother wasn't happy about it. And then soon after, he got reacquainted with a childhood friend named Daryl Hannah. Her dad was a billionaire and a donor to the Democratic Party. And she was also a famous movie star at the height of her career. His uncle Ted wanted Daryl's father to support him. And so he set John and Daryl up on a date. And since Daryl saw that John was a player, she also continued to see the person she was seeing before. And so they were never faithful to each other. Clever girl. She dumped John exactly 1 week before he took the New York bar exam, which may be the reason why he failed, because he was so devastated. And on top of that, he was humiliated. He failed the bar exam twice. And then there were these brutal headlines like this one. One of the pitfalls of fame, right? So he started working at the district attorney's office while waiting to retake the bar exam for the third time. But he always needed police escorts to get to the office because of all the press and attention from women. And of all the other interns, he was the only one who was given a secretary to help him deal with the sheer volume of mail that he received. What was he receiving in the mail? Love letters, women's underwear, invitations to parties, and pictures of naked girls. And so, with the viciousness from the media, and actually from anybody else that envied him, he needed to go into therapy to deal with to cope. After he failed the bar exam the second time, his cousins, his Kennedy cousins, were vicious to him. People mocked him. It was very, very hard. He felt inadequate, especially with the constant comparison to his father. He couldn't compete. He couldn't compete. But he finally passed the bar exam on the third attempt, and that silenced all the critics. And so he began to work as a prosecutor at the district attorney's office. And his job was made very easy, because many times the criminals would simply confess to him. He was just so likable. They would tell him, yes, I did it. You can find all the evidence here. I buried the body here, and you can find the weapon here. I hid the weapon here. And then after they got sentenced, they would say, thank you. It was great to meet you. He made his job so easy. So meanwhile, John continued his on and off relationship with Daryl Anna. But they quarreled a lot in public, which his mother didn't like. He went on holiday to Switzerland, Hong Kong, the Philippines, England, and Vietnam. Jackie wasn't happy about this relationship because she didn't think Daryl was good enough for John, because Daryl was flaky and they'd been photographed quarreling in public too many times. And besides, she was still seeing the other man she was dating. Eventually, she ended her other relationship and desperately wanted to marry John. She even bought a wedding dress and they got a marriage license. This was in 1993. And when Jackie saw that John was getting ready to marry Daryl Hannah, Jackie began to openly ignore Daryl. And so did John's sister. Anytime Daryl came to the house, they both left. If Daryl was coming over for dinner, then Jackie would eat in her bedroom. She never said anything, but her actions showed that she just did not support it. And so John eventually took the hint and broke up with Daryl Hannah. And around that time is when he met his future wife, Carolyn Bessette. Now, there are two different versions of the story of their relationship. And tonight, we'll review both versions. So, there's the official version, and then there's the version told by this man, Michael Bergen, a man who also dated Caroline, and he has quite the story to tell about their relationship. And as I told you earlier, I read another book. So, it was a book written by Michael Bergen, and I read it, you know, just to keep things balanced. So it's The Other Man, a love story, John F. Kennedy Jr., Carolyn Bessette, and me, written by Michael Bergen. So first we'll begin with the official version, and then we'll listen to his story. So JFK Jr. and Carolyn met
briefly at a charity event in New York City. And they were introduced to each other by the designer, Calvin Klein, whom she worked for. She worked as a personal shopper for the A-list clientele of the brand, the ones who get served caviar and champagne when they shop. So a few weeks after their meeting, John made up an appointment with Caroline and he bought three suits, six shirts, and many ties from her. And they kept their relationship mostly private at first. That's Caroline. She was quite intimidated by him at first, and she couldn't believe that this guy, whom everybody wanted, was interested in her. And she was so intimidated that she wouldn't pick his calls and she wouldn't return his calls. And it drove him nuts because every other woman was chasing him and Caroline didn't. But I mean, part of it could have been because she already had a boyfriend and she was actually pregnant when they first got together, but I digress. He never introduced Caroline to his mother because at the time he met Caroline, Jackie was receiving a treatment for cancer. And unfortunately, she lost the battle on May 19th, 1994. And shortly after Jackie died, John got back with Daryl Hannah. And Daryl Hannah was still two-timing him, which is funny because she desperately wanted to marry John. She was so desperate to marry John that she proposed to him twice. And she started giving him ultimatums. With Caroline, their relationship was unstable right from the start because John regularly showed up very, very late for their dates, or sometimes he just stood her up entirely. And also, she was still seeing her other boyfriend, Michael Bergen, the Calvin Klein model. And so sometimes she would use Michael to make John jealous. So meanwhile, John was trying to carve, a path for himself. And so with his friend and business partner, a man named Michael Berman, he founded a political magazine called George, named after George Washington. They worked really hard on it and they launched the magazine in 1997. And one of John's many exes, Cindy Crawford, agreed to be featured on the front cover. Was the first edition. John was pursued by actresses like Melanie Griffith around this time. And the actress Sharon Stone invited John and his girlfriend Caroline to dinner at her home. They had a wonderful dinner. And then 1 week later, John went back to see Sharon Stone privately. And then he started an affair. And the crazy part is that whilst that this was happening, he was living with his girlfriend Caroline. So Caroline was understandably furious about it. And then 2 months after he started his affair with Sharon Stone, he proposed to Caroline. And so Caroline said that she would think about it. Because, I mean, who would want to rush into marrying a man who had never been faithful to her? And besides, women regularly walked up to John and gave him their phone numbers right in front of Caroline. So, she was concerned about marrying him. Nevertheless, she eventually accepted his engagement ring and accepted. Caroline never met John's mom, but she did meet his aunt, Ethel, and Ethel was not impressed. After Caroline spent the weekend, Ethel reportedly said, quote, "If there is one thing I know, It's girls. Trust me, this one is all smoke and mirrors. Because Caroline didn't know anything about current affairs, and so she felt very foolish when asked about her opinion on things. Because, you know, the Kennedys were very into current affairs, being the kind of political dynasty they were. John and Caroline got into a huge public fight on February 25th, 1996. And we're going to watch a clip of that fight. I'm sure it's one of the most embarrassing moments of John's life. I couldn't find a version of it without a narrator. But well, let's see it anyway.
In America, he's John F. Kennedy Jr., considered the most eligible bachelor on the planet. And the woman on his arm is his girlfriend, Carolyn Bessette. They may look happy here, but it wasn't too long ago the pair were at each other's throats in a very public way. But now, for the first time, a friend of Carolyn's is speaking exclusively to American journals about what happened the day of the big fight.
I spoke to her a couple of times during all the episode of the fight.
Bobby DiMarzo is a photographer who met Carolyn 8 years ago when she was an undergraduate at Boston University.
We became very good friends really instantly. She was just a great girl.
DiMarzo says he wasn't surprised when he saw Carolyn letting JFK Jr. have it during their caught-on-tape fight.
She'll do what she wants to do, and whether you like it or not, she's going to get it done.
The explosive lover's spat reportedly started after the 28-year-old beauty accused her boyfriend of flirting with another woman at a party. The disagreement turns physical as John appears to rip a ring off her hand here. Supposedly, it was their engagement ring. As John walks off, leaving a shocked Carolyn standing there, she runs up from behind and tackles him, grabbing his neck as he fends her off. Suddenly, they were in each other's faces, screaming at the top of their lungs, and Carolyn didn't hesitate to shove and push him when he tried to walk away.
She stands up for what she wants, and she's not afraid to say no.
Then the pair sit on a park bench while Carolyn continues to scream. She gets up to leave, but then sits again in stony silence. Neither of them saying a word. After a while, Carolyn wipes tears away from her eyes. And as they leave the park, John walks a few feet behind her, his head hung low. The couple almost make it back to the apartment they share in Lower Manhattan when the fighting erupts again. John slumps to the sidewalk and buries his head in his arms. He seems to be crying. He looks dejected, defeated. Then Carolyn starts pacing. She extends her hand. You can see John dropping something into her hand. It is believed to be the engagement ring he tore from her finger earlier in the fight. Suddenly, Carolyn grabs for the dog's leash from her boyfriend's hands. He angrily yanks it back. The photographer who took these pictures says she heard JFK Jr. yelling, "You've got my ring. You're not getting my dog, too." And Carolyn reportedly screamed back, "It's our dog." She is finally seen leading the dog away. The couple console each other, but it's short-lived. Carolyn reads him the riot act once again.
She's got what she wants, and she's not going to back down.
JFK Jr. finally gets up and reluctantly follows Carolyn. The bickering continues, and then Carolyn bums a cigarette from a total stranger standing on the street. The couple, seemingly exhausted from fighting, finally make up. They embrace on the street, hug, and whisper into each other's ears. Carolyn seems to be sobbing once again. Young Kennedy and Carolyn start walking, but this time arm in arm, obviously reconciled from their all-out quarrel.
I can't believe that man is trying to defend it. I guess when you're famous, you're allowed to do things like that. I mean, I'm not in the limelight, and I've never done anything like that. I'd be so embarrassed to do something like that with a partner. Let alone someone who's doing, you know, being dating someone that high profile. She humiliated him. You could have any woman in the world, and this is who you end up marrying. It was very undignified. A few weeks after that fight, John almost caught Caroline in bed with her other boyfriend. And then
They married on September 21st, 1996, at the Little Baptist Church on Cumberland Island. Their wedding was kept so top secret, the press didn't know about it until 2 days after they'd gotten married, when this iconic photograph surfaced. And the paparazzi were furious. Half of America was angry about the marriage. And actually, even John's sister, Caroline, wasn't happy about it. She didn't know anything about her new sister-in-law at all. She hated how undignified Caroline was, especially after the street fight. And Caroline was 2 hours late to her own wedding. Her mother didn't want her to marry John. Caroline's mother didn't want her to marry John. On the eve of their wedding, at the rehearsal dinner, Caroline's mother gave a toast. And she said that she doesn't think this is the right marriage for her daughter, but she doesn't know what to do. Imagine your prospective mother-in-law saying that on the eve of your wedding. Anyway, so her nickname for John was Mouse, and his nickname for her was Kitty Cat. And according to the official version, they lived happily ever after and had a fairy tale marriage. Okay, now let's listen to the story of version two, as told in the book written by Michael Bergen. So Michael moved to New York City in 1992 when he was 23 years old. And he got a job working as a doorman at a hotel. He met Caroline at a club dancing. He was high on cocaine at the time because he was an aspiring model, and it was just what you did in the fashion industry. So he wrote his number on a matchbox and gave it to her. And it took her 5 days to call him. On the sixth day, she called him, and then they met. And their relationship was physical right from that day. Caroline was 3 years older than him. And he noticed that behind closed doors, she clung to him. She was always holding him and touching him. But in public, she was reserved. She never even touched his shoulder in public. These are pictures of them from their time together. You can read his comments about it over there and there. And so one day after they'd spent the night together at his place, he was walking her to her office, and then he heard a man call out, "Caroline!" And then he turned and he saw JFK Jr. riding by on a bike. And so he asked Caroline what was going on, and she said, "Oh, no, he's just a client, you know, he bought suits from me. Oh, he's a nobody." So Michael was jealous, but there was nothing he could do about it because Caroline was in charge. She only saw him when she wanted to, only returned his calls when she wanted to. Typically, it was days later. Everything in their relationship happened on her terms. So he saw pictures of Caroline on a boat with JFK at Martin's Vineyard. He confronted her about it, and again, Caroline denied it. "Oh, he means nothing to me. We're just friends." And after this confrontation, for the first time ever, Caroline kissed him in public on the sidewalk. And he was very concerned, but you know, each time he complained, she would reassure him. Then one day, while at her apartment, He was rummaging through Caroline's secret stash of magazines, and she saw he saw that she had numerous magazines with JFK Jr. on the cover, including his Sexiest Man Alive magazine. He confronted her about it, and she got angry again and told him, "Oh, he's nothing. Oh, how dare you go through my stash of magazines?" And he noticed that Caroline was reluctant to meet his family unless she was introduced as just his friend. She didn't want to be introduced as his girlfriend. So while they were together, Caroline got pregnant twice, and she had abortions both times. They were together for over a year, but she was still keeping him secret. But with Caroline's help, he landed the Calvin Klein underwear campaign, and then his modeling career took off. And even now that he was a successful model, she was still being distant and hiding him and, you know, pretending not to know him that well in public. And so one time he invited another model to a party he knew that Caroline would be attending, so that he would get her jealous and see how she would react. Well, Caroline lost her mind, and she attacked him right at the party. And then he left the party. She followed him home, went in and smashed up his apartment. It was unstable. So he temporarily moved to Milan for work because he landed a few jobs there. And while he was away, Caroline spent almost every weekend at the Hamptons with JFK Jr. But she told Mike that she told Michael that she wanted a holiday home on the water, and asked him if that was something he thought he would do. Well, he told her that he didn't think he could afford one. Then one morning when he returned to the US, he was watching TV with his sister while having coffee. And then there was a segment about JFK Jr.'s new love. And behold, it was Caroline. His family was stunned. And then suddenly pictures of JFK and Caroline were everywhere, on TV, magazines, and newspapers. There were pictures of them kissing in Central Park. But even now, he confronted Caroline about it, but she got angry. "It's nothing. He's just a friend. I'm with you. Isn't that enough?" And then a few weeks later, they were at Caroline's apartment, and JFK Jr. rang her buzzer. And Caroline made Michael use the fire escape to leave her apartment. It beggars belief, I know. Michael and Caroline continued to regularly meet up and have sex and do drugs. And she would wear a baseball cap pulled low on her face. Or sometimes she'll just come to see him because she missed him. And she'd say, "I just needed to see you." One night, Michael slept over at Caroline's place, and they were still in bed together when JFK Jr. suddenly arrived at her door. Once again, Michael had to sneak out of the window. This happened in April 1996. And then the next time he saw Caroline, there was this picture of her on a magazine cover. He was in shock. And then journalists started calling him and asking him about it and asking him to comment. Because after their wedding, their pictures were just everywhere. He couldn't escape. Nobody could. They were everywhere, the golden couple. Caroline and John, everywhere, all the time. And so he plastered on a fake smile and said, "Caroline is a terrific human being. JFK Jr. is a lucky man, and they'll be very happy together." And then a few weeks after her wedding, they met at a party. He congratulated her on her wedding. And then some weeks after that party, Caroline called him. This was on April 28th, 1997. And then she asked him, "When will I see you again?" So within their friendship circle, it was known that Caroline was unhappy in the marriage and she felt that she had made a mistake. And soon, newspapers were already reporting that JFK Jr. was having an affair and that Caroline was having an affair as well. And so Caroline visited Michael in Los Angeles and stayed for a week. Nothing happened the first two nights, but they began an affair on the third night. And when Caroline left, she left him her signature perfume, which was Egyptian musk. Throughout her marriage, she visited Michael on three separate occasions. And the last time she visited him was in the spring of 1998. And he noticed that this time Caroline was looking really gaunt. She looked sick. And she was doing drugs very heavily again, doing cocaine heavily. And she cried a lot. She was very skittish. She begged Michael to forgive her for what she had done for two-timing him and, marrying someone else whilst lying to him and stringing him along. And then she told him that she wanted out of her marriage and would Michael be willing to resume their relationship? And he said, absolutely not. Like, you want to bring the Kennedy family against me? And he said, no, he wasn't going to do it. He had already seen someone else and trying to move on with his life and told her that she made her bed. And he said, no. And he said that this is something that haunted him because it was their final parting. And the last thing he said to Caroline was no. So Caroline had a very difficult time in the marriage, especially being hounded by the paparazzi all the time. They called her horrible names, trying to get a rise out of her. Whenever she was by herself, they would call her a whore, a bitch, and other delightful little names. And then when she was with her husband, they'd be nicer. There was a time she tumbled down a flight of stairs and nobody helped her. They were just taking pictures of her. And this terrified her even more when Princess Diana was killed, because the same thing happened, right? When Diana died and the paparazzi was still taking pictures. Caroline and John had a very troubled marriage. John wanted kids. She did not. They were already in couples counseling. JFK Jr. was running a magazine, so he was working a lot. He was getting ready to run against Hillary Clinton for an open Senate seat. And it was said that this Senate seat was his for the taking. But first, he wanted to attend his cousin's wedding in Hyannisport before he would come back and make his intentions known about the Senate seat he wanted to run for. So now let's talk about John and his aviation. So John had secretly begun taking flying lessons in February 1988 at the Martha's Vineyard Airport. He was still as enthusiastic about flying as he had been in his childhood. So in June 1988, he broke the news to his mom and even introduced her to his flight instructor, a man named Arthur Marks. His mom, Jackie, didn't react and she remained perfectly calm and charming. But later on, she called John and begged him to stop with the flying lessons because Jackie had been having recurring nightmares about John dying in a plane crash. And these dreams terrified her because they were nothing like, a regular dream. It was as if it was real, as if she was She was there present and she witnessed her son die in a plane crash. Very, very vivid dream she was having. And they recurred all the time. So she told him, there have been too many deaths in the family. Begged him, please, son, don't fly. Don't fly, please. And so he stopped briefly and then secretly resumed a few months later. And he even took his then girlfriend, Christina Hag, on a flight to Catalina Island. John had always been a danger junkie. He did stupid things just for the thrill of it. There was a time he nearly caused an avalanche by skiing in a restricted area. He continued flying a plane that was low on fuel. He rode his kayak in the direct path of a ferry, even when the ferry honked at him to get out of the way. He and Christina had nearly drowned in the ocean due to his carelessness. The nickname his friends had for him was Master of Disaster. So, you know, his friends and family knew him well, which is why everyone warned him about flying. If ever there was a preventable accident in history, if ever, it was this. And even in those last minutes, all John had to do was push two buttons and he could have saved all their lives. And I was like, but let's not get ahead of ourselves. On Jackie's deathbed, on his mother's deathbed, she made him swear. He swore that he wouldn't fly. She also made Uncle Ted and her partner at the time promise to prevent John from flying, his own planes. He had ADD. He was too absent-minded to be a pilot. Nevertheless, he obtained a pilot's license and he bought a Piper Saratoga. He also owned a Buckeye ultralight aircraft. Looks very flimsy. You know, sometimes life warns you before something major happens to you. 6 weeks before his death, 6 weeks, John had crashed his Buckeye and broken his ankle. And in fact, his leg was still in a cast on the night he died. Look at this picture. Look at the date. June 15th, 1999. Like almost exactly 1 month. Exactly 1 month before he died. He was still using clutches and the leg was still in the cast. So Caroline usually avoided going in the private plane with John. She will take commercial flights and then they'll meet up at their destination. She did not trust John as a pilot, and rightly so. John and Caroline were in a very bad marriage. He had moved out and he was living at the Stanhope Hotel in New York City. And Caroline told anyone who had ears that John wasn't her type. He had never been her type and that she had never been attracted to him. Had they lived, I believe they would have divorced. They were not even on speaking terms. And so Caroline's sister, Lauren, hurriedly got them reconciled the day before they died. Caroline, that's Caroline's sister, Lauren. So she got them reconciled. Because she wanted to make sure they went together to his cousin Rory's wedding that weekend. And so they reconciled the night before. And so was the following day, the day of their trip, is when Caroline had to rush around buying a dress, doing her hair and getting her nails done. John barely slept the night before their trip. Because he was preparing for some very important meetings pertaining to his magazine. And so he had series of meetings that day, and he'd worked all night. And then a more experienced pilot offered to accompany them as a co-pilot on this flight, but John inexplicably refused. And so after working the entire day and, you know, attending his series of meetings, he left the office late and he got stuck in Friday rush hour traffic. And so did Caroline. And so they both arrived late at the airport to take their flight. John hadn't counted on the changes in the weather and poor visibility at all when getting ready for the flight. And so what they planned to do, there were going to be three of them together because Lauren was coming along with them. So she was going to go meet up with her friends at Martha's Vineyard. So the plan was John, Caroline, and Lauren would leave together from New York. They would drop off Lauren at the Martha's Vineyard airport, and then John and Caroline would fly on to Hyannisport for his cousin's wedding. So now, they left at 8:30 p.m. So it was already dark. So apparently, a vital part of the training to become a pilot is geared at helping pilots remain calm in the middle of pandemonium. You know, because, you know, say something goes wrong 30,000 feet in the air, or there's, you know, very, very violent turbulence and people are screaming their heads off. Pilots are trained to have nerves of steel and to stay calm. John hadn't done this training yet. He hadn't done a lot of the required training. He should not. He had no business flying a plane at night on his own. So it was dark and hazy when they took off that night. And had John received the proper training, all he had to do was press two buttons and engage autopilot. They have had a smooth flight. Plane that didn't help them with the landing. Their lives could have all been saved. But he didn't. And he could not see where they were going. In fact, within minutes of takeoff, he nearly crashed into an American Airlines passenger jet. But the pilot of that commercial airplane moved out of the way, thus saving their lives and the lives of all the other people on board his craft. 40 minutes into the flight, everything was inky black and John got disoriented. And for reasons nobody knows, he turned off his radio. So he couldn't even communicate with, you know, people on the ground. Other more experienced pilots radioed for help because it was so dark that night. John did not. And then he experienced something called spatial disorientation. So it's where you may be flying upside down and you won't know it. Because when you're up in the air, you get disoriented. Your body may tell you that this is left, this is right, this is up, this is down. But you may be upside down and you won't know it. And so John got confused. He began to pull on the wrong levers and instruments, which caused jerky, bouncy movements. It didn't help that his leg was in a cast, and so he couldn't control or maneuver the plane very well. And according to people who recreated their flight, there is no way that his wife and sister-in-law were not screaming in terror by this time. They were in terror because people who recreated the flight said that it was just really jerky. It was worse than any turbulence anybody has ever experienced. The plane was descending at 5,000 feet per minute. Imagine that. So they were in a state of pure terror already. And as mentioned earlier, John hadn't received the training to, grant him nerves of steel. And getting screamed at like that got him even more flustered. And so even if he had known certain things, he probably forgot them. So he was supposed to have leveled the wings of the plane before pulling up the yoke, because that's what happened when you're about to land the plane. But John forgot to level the wings, and he just pulled the yoke. And this caused the plane to go into something known as the graveyard spiral. When a plane is in graveyard spiral, sorry, you're finished. The speed is even faster, and the G-force is so powerful that it forces the air out of your lungs. So you cannot even scream when you're in a plane that is in this spiral. You're completely paralyzed, and the only thing you can do is listen to the sounds of the engine and wait to crash. Their last moments were horrendous, horrible. They crashed into the ocean. And it was just miles from the coast, just miles from Martha's Vineyard. Meanwhile, the friends and family who were expecting them at the Martha's Vineyard airport reported that their plane had not arrived hours after it should have. Everyone was in a panic, and the news media got a hold of the story. Then President Bill Clinton authorized the most intensive rescue operation in US history. It involved the Coast Guard, the Navy, the Air Force, and thousands of civilians participated, looking for them. So their bodies and the wreckage were recovered 5 days later on July 21st, 1999. I'm not going to share pictures of their bodies, just the wreckage of their plane. I don't have to tell you how devastated John's sister was. Caroline was devastated. He begged him to stop the flying. Everybody begged him to stop. Oh, how about Caroline's mom? How about Anne Freeman? Caroline's mom. She lost two daughters. And Caroline's sister, Lauren, had a twin sister. She was a twin. And then, during those five agonizing days before their bodies had even been recovered, the Kennedy family made it clear to Anne that John and Caroline would not be buried together. They literally said to her, "You can do with Caroline as you please." You say that to a grieving mother, woman who just lost two children. She never forgave the Kennedy family. And she was never unable to utter John's name ever again. And she banned anybody from ever uttering John's name in her presence or in her home ever again. So they were eventually buried at sea. They were buried at sea the day after their bodies were found, because their bodies were in such a horrible state after 5 days in the ocean. But she regrets the decision because she had no place to go, no grave sites to go, and visit her children. She sued the Kennedy estate and was awarded $15 million because she lost the children due to John's recklessness. But it's not as if she ever enjoyed the money. She was so devastated, so heartbroken. She remained indoors for the next 8 years after losing both her daughters. America mourned him. And even today, there's still this sense of loss and, you know, nostalgia. What a wasted opportunity. All this sense of what could have been. Because he seemed destined, he had it all. You know, just squandered, just all gone like that. And so, to end this presentation, I will play a tribute video for John and Caroline. Maybe they didn't have the best marriage, but, well, they died together. They had a short, horrible marriage, but they died together. It was a real, real tragedy. So I'm going to share this tribute to them. And now we come to the end of this presentation. Very sad ending, I know. Such a wasted opportunity, lost potential.
But well, still a very interesting life story. So I hope you guys at least enjoyed that. And thank you very much. And see you at the next one. Ciao, ciao.